I have the unenviable position of dinner speaker. So dinner speakers are usually entertaining, that is not going to be the case today. Really, what I'm going to do is talk a little bit more about some of these very interesting trends, because I feel like as you look at writing code, we're at a very unique place in time, and the Intel discussion presented this as well. And it's hard to write code that sort of future-proofs, you know, where we expect things to go. But I'm going to point out some of the issues. I don't have solutions, just some of the things happening. And you should start thinking on your own and start looking around. What will that mean for my code? What will it mean for architectures in the future? And then, hopefully, there'll be enough time just for some speculation about what's really happening in computers, not just in HPC. So these are slides taken from Peter Kogi, who has been looking at chips and scaling. And these slides were also represented in the Intel slides this morning. Let me just highlight that some of the observations that you've seen already several times is that we've hit, for example, a power ceiling. By power ceiling, I mean how much total power you put in a socket, the total design point. And back in the dotted line here, which is very interesting, is in 2004. So really, in 2004, the world changed, according to Peter Kogi here. And it's just been a while since we've realized it and caught up with it. So we kind of hit this point where we said, okay, the chip really can't get much hotter, it can't dissipate much more. We stopped scaling the clock. And also, if you look at sockets and cores, we had this wonderful period for about almost 10 years where in high-performance computing, people who had large parallel programs, they scaled up to maybe 8,000 cores. All they did was wait. And the next computer would come out, and they'd recompile, and it would also be about the same performance. They'd have to tweak things up, but they didn't have to change their scaling much, because the total number of cores was really in this flat spot. In other words, machines weren't doubling in the amount of parallelism every generation. Now, as you know, right, we're in this place where we see this incredible ramp here where the parallelism in your application is increasing, whether it doubles or not. It's just increasing dramatically with every generation. So we have this problem. This is illustrated very well by Peter's slides, that we can't make things take much more power per package. We've hit the clock ceiling. We're now scaling by just adding parallelism. And so there's a power problem at the heart of this. That power problem then translates into all sorts of other problems with memory and all the ways that we talked about, like trading flops for communication. The reason for that, flops are cheap, it's a power issue. And communication is the expensive one. So if we look just as an example of this, I want to look at BlueJean. So this is the BlueJean Q system, which you've seen. But I want to compare it to the BlueJean P system, which we had just prior to that, and it was just decommissioned. So BlueJean Q is about 20 times faster. Okay, so that's pretty great. You know, over the course of several years between BlueJean P and BlueJean Q, you expect this. It's several years later. It's about 20 times faster for comparing comparable sizes. It turns out to take four times more power. More electrical power, more wall clock, or I mean wall socket, right? Plug right in power. So that means that it was really five times more power efficient. So this is also pretty impressive. It means that the designers at IBM, from generation P to generation Q, improved the efficiency by a factor of five. Okay, so you're like, woohoo. All right, so let's just keep doing that. Well, therein lies the problem. If we take this now, BlueJean Q, and say, hey, let's just make it five times more efficient for the next version, and then five times more efficient again, just like every time you turn the crank, if it were five times more efficient, well, now you can see that just doing it, we get to 64 megawatts, okay, of power. And if you want to keep going on this curve, right, you can now see where the problem lies, even though we're assuming that we're going to get more efficient. This isn't saying, oh, let's take today's technology and we'll just, you know, we'll scale it up, we'll make more. No, I'm going to improve the efficiency by a factor of five, and I still get this really quite horrible looking number, 64 megawatts. Now, to put that in perspective, right, a megawatt is about $1 million a year in electricity. So to run this kind of computer, if we don't change something dramatically, $64 million, well, okay, now we're in trouble, right? So the machine itself costs $100 million. It's going to cost, in 2 years, we will have equaled that. Com Edison then, you know, makes all the money. IBM goes out of business. The electric company makes all the money on supercomputers, right? So this is the heart of the problem. So there are many different solutions that people are looking at, and it's been an international problem. This is not an IBM problem. It's not an Intel problem. It involves the whole community. So I was recently in Japan talking to with the DOE, looking and talking to the people there on their exascale plans. What are they going to do to solve exascale? And they have a big push to do this. And they are trying to target 2020. Now, that's very aggressive to get to exascale. It's extremely aggressive. And they have not yet passed this through all the funding issues in Japan, although it is the official funding plan. And they have also decided they want to partner with the United States on the design of some of the system software. So I'll show you in the next slide, but we have a partnership. We've signed a letter, a memorandum of agreement between the US and Japan on the system software to improve these systems for Japan, because all of the regions in the world are realizing that getting to the next level of performance is going to take more than just their own, okay, we'll all go huddle somewhere and we'll do it. We need to collaborate internationally. And you can see that in the top 500, just as an example, you know, all sorts of countries and regions are representative. This list was the same as the previous list, with the exception there's been one change in the top 10. It's a another cluster or a machine that's in the U.S., and we don't know where it is. It just says U.S. government. So I don't know. Is that Salt Lake? Is that in Utah? Is that in, I don't know. So as I said, this agreement was just signed with the Japanese at ISC. And there will be a significant collaboration between the Japanese. And the Europeans are also looking to do this amongst Japanese and the Americans to collaborate on the system software. And what do we need to do to reach exascale? And why do I keep focusing on the system software? Well, I'll get to that in just a moment, because many of these changes that happen in the hardware are as a result of things happening that they need to be reflected in the system software and eventually up to the user. Europe is not standing around either. So there's a very big push right now that a new funding call in Europe called Horizon 2020. They expect to spend 700 million euros. Now that's euros, so that's real money. And specifically, one of the very interesting things here is let's see if you can see it in this slide here. So the right here, it's the PPP. It's a public-private partnership. So one of the things that Europe wants to do is make sure that with this huge investment in the next generation of HPC, that they end up with an HPC industry that isn't in the US. So the Europeans feel slightly uncomfortable with the fact that right now many of the computers that they buy are designed by companies that have research groups that are in Europe and in the US, but their primary home is in the United States, even though Intel has a huge research lab in Europe, so does IBM. In fact, I think most of IBM's research scientists are now in India in their labs. I'm not joking. IBM's research labs, right, Watson and others, the total number of scientists in Watson and Austin, I think the total number of scientists in India is now exceeds that. So it's a global issue, but Europe does very much want to come out of this next generation of technology as a place that is leading in the technology and creating their own supercomputers out of Europe. China has shown tremendous investment And you can see, this is their block diagram, but you can see their machine. It's a machine that relies heavily on the Intel part right now, but they're working very, very hard on developing their own technology, and they have other machines that develop their own CPUs and their own interconnect. So we can expect to see the next machine from China, one of the next machines, probably in the top 10, with all homegrown technology from the interconnect and the CPU. And you can start to see, now one way to look at this number, 24 megawatts, is that Intel is extremely power efficient. Another way to look at it might be, wow, $24 million a year in power alone. Now, because of that, I'm told that that machine is not actually turned on all the time. You know, we talked earlier about being charged, you know, for CPUs, how many CPUs you use, no matter what. Well, certainly, if the machine is on, you're being charged, right? The power company is charging you. So, if we look at this history of supercomputers, this is a classic slide that many of you have probably seen, which is the top 500, the machines ranked, and this is the fastest machine, the sum of all the performance. This is the current fastest machine. This is a bit old, this slide. And this is the bottom performer. And it's been marching up. And you say, oh, well, you know, just going to keep marching, right? Now, some interesting things, though, is sort of where we've come from, right? So this was the machine. You saw a picture earlier. I showed you a picture that had a CM5 in it. That's an old parallel computer long ago. And that CM5 in 1993 is the same power as my laptop today. Right, so here's my laptop over here in 2014. And so if you look at the time difference here, we see that it's approximately a 20-year time machine. So what is available in supercomputing, what has been available in supercomputing, in 20 years, you have on your desktop. Right, you have your laptop. So my laptop now is my CM5 from 1994. Right, pretty remarkable. Can this trend continue? Well. You know, Intel would be the guys to talk to about device technology because at the device level, things are under stress, right, with how big feature size is and so forth. So where will the revolution happen, right? Is there a revolution that's needed? I mentioned that 64 megawatt number. Unless something changes significantly, unless there really is a revolution of some sort in that path, then we really can't get off that curve that says, well, we're going to have a 64 megawatt supercomputer, right? And it's, as I said, it's about power. It's about how much total dissipation, both a number of chips and the total dissipation of each of the chips. So there are several areas that are under stress as we change the architecture to accommodate this, to reduce the power. I'm going to list just a couple. We really have at the top sort of applications. I say co-design because the DOE has been working very hard on these co-design centers. You might hear more about that later. And they've also been injecting dollars in the bottom here in the exascale platforms with Fast Forward and Design Forward. This is money directly to vendors to improve performance or try new research topics in the chip and in packaging and in interconnects. So let's look at memory threads and so forth. So this is a slide from Rob Schreiber, and I put it up here only to point out that we've had the same sort of memory for a long time. So DRAM is a really nasty type of memory. I mean, it's really just you know, you look back in designs and you think, really, this is what we have? What DRAM essentially does is you put a little bit of charge somewhere to make a 1 or a 0, and then over time it starts to fade, and then you have to put it back. And it is extremely inefficient in that regard, but also in how much power it takes. It's just very power hungry. And right now, if you run tests and do some very interesting research on power in a CPU, you find that the power of the memory system is starting to crank up because of this leakage that happens between, you know, as you how fast you when you give it a one, how long it takes before you have to give it another one to refresh it. So there are other technologies coming about. And these are all in the lab here, but we should expect to see a sea change, a new change in the technology that we have for memory. And what will this do to our programming model? Will this, or do we just say, okay, it's memory, so we don't have to change much in the programming model? Or will it change the programming model substantially? Well, let me point out two things. One is that some of the technologies that are out there are non-volatile. So that means that I could imagine in the future a node where all the memory stays around between runs. Or I can store part of my files right there on the nodes. Well, that would change my programming model. That would change the system software significantly. Another thing is that, as Intel pointed out, there might be many different kinds of memory. There might be high bandwidth memory, or there might actually be fast memory. but there might be many kinds of memory. And why would you want many kinds of memory? Well, it would be because the trade-off of where you put your data might be that you can't pay the power budget of having all of it fast or all of it high bandwidth, so you have a hybrid. That's how we solve most problems in computer science, right? We don't pick algorithm A or algorithm B. No, we'll find where to cross over between algorithm B and algorithm A. And the same holds true for memory. So where that memory goes is also in question. So in the past, as Intel pointed out, memory has been the one thing that's still outside the processor. We keep pulling cache in. What if we pulled all of memory in? And this is a picture from quite some time ago. There are new pictures, but the problem is that a lot of the new pictures I have are NDA pictures. So this is still an open picture, which shows what a 3D memory with lots of stacked data pieces next to a CPU. In fact, in many of the designs now, this 3D memory piece sits directly on top of the CPU. And in fact, this picture is very deceiving because it makes it look like the CPU is big and the memory is small. In the actual way of the design of these, the memory footprint in terms of stacking the memory is big, and then there's the little CPU underneath. I could add more underneath there because the memory is so big. But what does this mean for us as system software or programmers? What it means right now is that you have one view of the world, which is I have a cache, and it's transparent. I don't actually address into the cache. I have all of these things that Torsten talked about, things happening behind the scenes with validation and invalidation and copies, and it's all behind the scenes. I really only have a construct of I have a memory location, and then I have far, far away, right? Network or disk. Well, if we have this kind of arrangement, and this is really where we're going, I'm not an if, this will be the arrangement, then I have cache, I have some memory, I have some more memory that's stacked in 3D, and now what do I call that? Do I set that different variables to that space? How do I even, in a programming model, how do I set different variables to be in that space? And then I have NVRAM, which might store persistent objects. Well, again, right now our only concept of persistent objects is a file system, right? And then I have stuff that goes off and with an interconnect to a remote node. So we have a number of problems. Again, I'm only specifying the challenges, sort of looking out into the future. We're going to have in our runtime systems a way in which to dynamically move data to NVRAM, a way in our runtime systems and in our programming languages to define placement that's a little bit smarter than what we have now for what kind of access we expect. I can imagine, for example, putting some data, and there's been great research where someone says, if I just look at a program and map out all the data accesses to your data blocks in a scientific application, how many of those are write once, read many? How many of them are write and read constantly, changing a lot? And then how many of them are mistakes, which are write once, never read? And there are actually programs that do that too, right? And it turns out that there's a significant amount of your memory that you write once and you read multiple times. Well, that's perfect for some of these low power and NVRAM kinds of solutions. So the programming model is going to have to change significantly. We're also, chip manufacturers are looking at coherence islands, right? So rather than trying to manage cache over an entire die, maybe you have sections, right? Again, from a programming model perspective, how are we going to manage? We've always thought of memory when you declare a variable, it all seems very flat, right? Int I. right? Not int I there or what the how it will migrate. And adding persistence to the Prairie model, as I said, we only have file systems now. Why can't we, when will we have persistent struct, where I take a struct and I say, this struct is persistent because I plan to reuse it between these calls, between these programs, and programming for processing in memory. So I mentioned this earlier, but I just want to come back and point out one more time that this notion that the machine is consistent and equal work is equal time, as I said, that's really going away. And I'm going to show a little bit more picture of that. And variability is the new norm, right? And the question is really how variable. And as a programmer, this is going to be your big challenge as you look into the future, is saying, how much latency do I need to design my algorithm to absorb? That's not an easy question to answer, right? Is it one iteration, two iterations? Is it more than that? How often will I need to do load balancing? So over decomposition is the key. Now, one of the things that there was a paper recently by Google, which I enjoy, because you know, there are times when the HPC world is told, well, how come you don't go talk to the people in the business world and the commercial world like Google? They've got all these data centers. They have to be really far out ahead. And then the opposite happens. They all get asked, well, how come you aren't talking to the supercomputer guys? Those supercomputer guys know what they're doing. This is an example of sort of Google rediscovering something that in HPC you guys have known, hopefully, for years and years. So this was a paper that showed, gee, you know what? If I run a query, the more servers I have that participate in that query, and the more variability there is in terms of response time, I start to run as slow as the slowest server, right? And the probability of that goes up with the bigger the machine, right? So if I have 10,000 nodes, well, I'm always going to run as slow because the probability of one of them coming back a little bit slower than that slow one. So they wrote this paper calling the tail at the scale. And I just want to point out, here are their observations, the summary of the paper. So one is, it says, well, you know, a common technique for reducing latency is, you know, we have this problem with this, you know, component variability, right? Which I've already talked about. I said in HPC systems, that's what we have. So, well, you can try and reduce component variability. Now, this back in the day, this was called OS noise, jitter, right? Oh, let's make sure that equal work and equal time is the same. We'll try to get rid of all variability. Well, you can't, right? So then the conclusion of the paper is, well, okay, you got to live with it, right? You got to live with component variability, careful engineering, and so forth. Well, this is the problem. This scale problem is the same scale problem you have in HPC, and it's the same scale problem I mentioned here with variability, is that the architecture will begin to show even more variability between components, and your algorithms and your approaches, whether it's tasks or threads, will address that in the future. And so as we look toward exascale, the programmer who can master this feature well will do well, right? We've also seen send and receive. Well, you know, gee, we've been doing, I mean, Rusty pointed out, send and receive. I mean, it's 10 years it was resting, right? The interface for MPI was resting. We think, well, we've mastered send and receive. But it turns out that as we look to increasing parallelism, I just said that parallelism was going to keep increasing, right? We're going to add more and more threads per core. Well, now you can imagine that you could have millions of outstanding threads that are all asking for send or receive. So you're going to, the amount of traffic, in some sense, the amount of small bits of sends and receives, that also has to be scaling up, just like the parallelism. So now our MPI implementations, just something as simple as the messaging implementation, has to be able to handle millions and millions of outstanding small pieces, which are all a response to hiding latency. How do you hide latency? You put more work to more things waiting so that there's something always ready to do, right? So this sort of change affects everything, including our MPI implementation. Now, there's been a lot of discussion about fault and about fault prediction. And I point out that you know, people say, oh, at exascale, all the parts are going to be faulty, and we have resilience will be a big problem. And they're all indications are that that is a problem. However, our ability to predict that as a problem has been abysmal. So this is a paper that was published, quite some time ago. I won't tell you who wrote the paper. It's back from 2007. And what the presenters do is they take parts at that instant in time in 2007, and they say, if parts fail like this in the future, and we have millions of them, we'll get a curve that shows by 2018, machines will be breaking every 5 seconds, right? Well, okay, so this is kind of like saying, I want to build an exascale computer tomorrow using the exact same power technology I have today, and I just say I want to multiply it by 1,000, so how many megawatts is it going to be? It's failing to take into account that we'll have improvements in our ability to resist fault in the hardware itself. So you can't take 2007 numbers and project to 2018 and say, gee, if we keep failing at this rate, 2018, this is where we'll be. So my point here is that fault prediction is very hard to say what the industry, because this is motivated by making money. Intel has to sell chips that work. If they don't sell chips, well, I suppose they don't sell chips that don't work. That's a pretty easy thing to do. So where we all land with respect to resilience, I'm still in question about, right? So I still worry about. I think we should watch it, but I think as a programmer right now, you need to look at your strategies in your code for resilience and not worry too much about this sort of boogeyman that's happening with resilience. It is important, but I think we have to take a careful approach to it. Power. So. Earlier, when I said there will be variability in the chip, our friends from Intel got up and said, it's not the hardware's fault. It is. So this is a slide put together a couple weeks ago by one of the guys who works for me, exploring power and temperature on a Sandy Bridge. So this experiment is very simple. He starts out with a room temperature chip, just like today, right now in the room. Imagine just powering it on. And you run a benchmark on it. And you run it, and it starts at run 0, and you start running all the way up to run 50 or 60. And you can see that the total energy required to make that computation is going up. So stop and think about this for a second. The energy required to do the computation is increasing over time. How can that be, right? I'm running the same computation, 0th time. I'm running a computation on the 40th time, and it takes me a significantly more amount of energy to run that computation. Well, it's because the chip is heated up. The warmer the chip, the less efficient it is, and so the more energy it takes. Okay, so that means that there's actually this interesting variability even right here, but what's worse is the variability is across all of the cores in the chip. So now we take a look at, there are 16 cores, and we look at the temperature on each of the cores while we do this. So we're running, again, the 0 to 90th iteration. And you'll see here that this core is significantly, it's the same die, right? It's the same machine. This core is significantly cooler than this core. Now, it turns out that the reason for this research is looking at future system software, can we imagine doing load balancing? Again, as I said, there's, equal work is not equal time. Can we imagine doing load balancing, which brings this temperature down to the midpoint and gives that extra work to this core to bring it up, right? And the closer we are to temperature equivalence, the more likely we are to get the best performance out of the chip, right? So it's these kind of features, and this is only going to get exaggerated as we continue the power march to get more than 5x in power efficiency as we turn the crank. As we continue that, this is going to widen. It's not going to shrink, right? This will get to, you already see here, from 50 to 70, the temperature change, right? So this is going to get quite significant as we look into the future. And another simple example, we're collaborating with someone from Northwestern. The same thing happens on a DIMM. So this is someone else's work here. But you can see here's a RAM DIMM, and there's the buffer in the middle. and they're plotting temperature. They've taken and put a temperature sensor on each one of the RAM chips all the way across here. And you can see the temperature gradient across the RAM chips all the way up. And the buffer in the middle, of course, is the hottest, and then down here. And in this case, what they did is they said, what if we changed our memory allocator to allocate the next page in the place on the DIMM where it's the coolest? Will we improve the performance? And they improved the performance of an application by having the operating system choose where to put the page based on the temperature of the DIMMs, right? So this is the kind of future world for system software, right? Running underneath your application, trying to optimize power, trying to optimize temperature, trying to guess where the computation should go, and that's why things will be variable, right? There's no more static anymore. When a runtime system is moving where your computation goes on the chip or where your pages are allocated, you're in that part of the world. Okay, so we have architecture, memory, threads, messaging, resilience, power. These are all the areas for change over the next few years. Now, as I said, it's kind of difficult for me to tell you exactly what to do. But as the week in sum progresses, you should continue exploring what this means. What does hierarchical memory likely to mean? What will I do with respect to looking at the performance of my application for over decomposition, as I said, so that you can do some load balancing in your application. And also, as pointed out earlier, not to write your own pieces where you can borrow someone else's or steal someone else's, right? Okay, so I have time for a couple questions, and then I'm going to get to some more out there fun stuff. Question or objection? From the Intel representative in the back. Go ahead.
We're going to keep giving you variability so we can all stay employed. I think I learned something. TPP works real hard to use things hot in cache. I think you just told me we should try to use cold memory instead. You were very careful to use the word resilient instead of an old term, fault tolerant. And I have some notion of why that is, but could you say a little bit about why the industry sort of shifted to saying resilient systems instead of fault tolerant?
I actually don't know what is motivating the big difference. I think that people want a variety of techniques to avoid and repair along the way. And fault tolerant always brings the connotation that something has failed and now I respond to the failure. And there's a lot of work. I mean, Frank Capello, for example, has found several cases where they're able to predict something is going to go awry and move the computation or make a change before it ever went awry. In that case, was it fault tolerant? Well, there was never a fault. So, but I think it is a new name for new funding, as we always need, right? Yeah.
If you show again your graph with the consumption of power, this one. So what I see here is that as you do more runs, actually the curve tends to flatten out.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that means if I use the chip and I load it enough, right, with operations, eventually it's going to get to a steady state and it's going to maintain the temperature.
Yes, but there's still this difference here. And that what we haven't done in this test is that if you change the workload, then you are able, this is with the same workload. If I change the workload and add more flops to this core, I can make this go up, right? So this does show the certain sense of the heating, the heat capacity of the package. But then the point of the heat the difference here is this. What will we do about this? How will we code future runtime systems to take advantage of where things cool? And it really comes back to this picture. Is that no matter what you do, the machine does have a physical instantiation, right? And there will be parts of the machine that are hotter than others. And in this case, the CPU might be next to the memory, and there's always going to be a line of cores, no matter how well I put a heatsink on there, there's going to be a line of cores that are hotter because it's next to the memory than the opposite side of the die. And in which case, more work should go to that opposite side of the die, right? Because it's going to be done more efficiently, and you can increase the clock speed and all sorts of other things. You know, Intel will give you different clock speeds for different cores, different power domains, all of that.
So that becomes basically a characteristic of the chip.
Yep. Yeah, go ahead. Can MPI-3 solve the resilience problem? I will queue that up for tomorrow. Because Bill has a...
Will it make margaritas?
Will it make margaritas? Bill has a very good discussion about how difficult fault tolerance and correctness is. And anyway, we should save that one. Yeah.
So how significant are those performance differences from the energy and the heat differences?
It is pretty significant, and I mean, you can see from there it's 10, 20, 30% difference. But what's more important is that in order to get more efficiency as we look forward in time, those differences have to get bigger, right? I mean, we have to do better at this management. So the chip designers are going to give us more and more tools to manage coherency, power. It's already the case that with your cell phone, for example, that it can only run flat out in its highest performance mode for, I think it's a few milliseconds, before it has to start winding down and slowing down because of heat and power issues.
Yeah. It's not necessarily a concern now, but it does point out a risk,
well,
future trend.
Yeah, but it is it's a concern now. Why I'm going to hypothesize here that a really efficient runtime system, which did like the memory example they did, that essentially it's possible to squeeze performance out of current systems by looking at these kind of techniques, and it'll only become more important in the future.
So with the memory, for example, did that person have any numbers as far as a percentage?
Yeah, it was. I think it was 5 or 10%. Yeah,
that's significant.
Yeah.
Are people willing to give up accuracy?
Oh, so that's another very good question. Was, are people willing to give up accuracy? There are a lot, and I didn't mention that there has been a lot of work in variable precision and near threshold voltage, which gives you certain accuracy. Issues and I'll leave it to this would be a great question to ask Demel. Yeah, I was gonna say David later in the week, but those are very good questions.
You didn't mention the network size or topology. Is there a reason why you left that out?
I didn't mention that, and I don't really know what will happen there. The interesting thing, as Intel pointed out, is everyone is bringing as much as they can onto the die. So the network adapter, the end point, will come on the die. Now, what goes in the middle to give you topology, that router piece, that I don't think we have I haven't seen any enormous changes there yet. You change, 5D, 10D, different topologies, but there's not a big technology change that will impact us that I've seen yet. There was a question in the back.
In your temperature plot, you mentioned that this difference between the hottest core and coldest core is going to increase by time.
Yes.
Why is that? Isn't the trend like more number of cores and less energy per core?
So your question is that why will this spread continue?
Yeah, I mean, in the future, when the number of cores increase, I thought that the energy required for each core is going to decrease, so this temperature variance will not be as much as today.
Right. So what happens is that, so my understanding, and we can ask our Intel friends here, we're going to always throw it over to you. My understanding is that, so we're always running it up to the thermal design point. Right, so the total package design point. So that's what's happening. You're running all of them up as high as you can. Now, the real question is, when you run all of them up as fast as you can to dissipate however many hundred watts you're going to dissipate, are they all equally hot? And will all of them have or use the equal amount of energy?
It's
Actually, a little more sophisticated than that. We measure or estimate, depends on the design, temperature, local temperatures and package. We have to stay in a thermal limit for the package. That's usually to meet spec, so that the cabinet can keep you cool. But we have to pay attention to local temperatures. So you can aggravate a core on a Xeon or a Xeon Phi and cause that core to throttle independent of the rest because of a local temperature problem. And temperature will dissipate based on the case and the silicon eventually. But and if we don't do that, that part of the chip will melt. And you don't want that, so we'll have to buy a new chip. As much as you think we want to sell them, we don't want to sell them in those circumstances. So, yeah, that local thing, it will heat unevenly. So the answer to your question is no. If you've got 61 cores and you hit the rate, the power is probably not dissipated evenly.
I think the other thing for us to that is a fun dinner discussion that you guys should be looking at is about the other end of the spectrum. So we have now machines that are getting very good at, or algorithms that are getting very good at machine learning, at putting together an incredible size of data available and learning from that data and creating a new service. A perfect example is how we do language translation now. Right. So right now, in the old days, right, computer language translation was looking at a word and putting in a dictionary, okay, this word means this or has this these synonyms, right? Now, language translation is done statistically. We have languages, we have governments that publish documents in two official languages, right, like say French and English, and by looking statistically at thousands and thousands of documents, a computer, Google and others can get, and by using the right kind of learning techniques, right, can understand or present a new algorithm that says, I'm going to translate between language A and language B using this set of rules, right, using this database that I've built by analyzing documents. It's not a human in there, it's a machine learning, it's an algorithm. And if we look at the future, and we look at where all of these sorts of things to apply. How many of you remember Watson, right? You know, the Jeopardy computer, right? There's another example of this. So as we look to the future and we look at where applications will come from, and I think that as we look at supercomputing, we should be looking at how we're amassing that data and analyzing it and the learning that's happening in these programs. I mean, if I have this app on my phone called WordLens. It does the translation in place. So I can be at a restaurant and put my phone, it does the image recognition of the menu, it translates it from Italian to English in the fly, and it shows me the menu with the words flipped back and forth between English and Italian, or English and German, English and German. This happens in a way that is being absorbed everywhere else in society with these large databases being constructed. The automation that's going in and the way in which we're exploring the data, I think, is something that we talk mostly about computation upstairs. But the real question is, as we build these systems and as we analyze language, automation, self-driving cars, self-flying planes, right? As we move to larger and larger data sets that we can use to do algorithms on, where will we end up? What can we predict for the future? At what point in the future, as an example, at what point in the future will your insurance company give you a break if you let the car drive itself? Right? I mean, we all talk about, well, you know, what about liability and so forth? Well, really, it'll be the other way around, right? The insurance company right now, you have that module you plug into your car, right? And then depending on if you drive politely, you might get a lower rate, right? Well, when will it be the case that you tell the insurance company, okay, it will keep track of how often the car drives and give you a rate based on the car driving versus you driving, right? And so we should be, as computer scientists or application folks, we should be thinking about these sort of issues and about the ethical issues as well further out, right? Because it is clear that the kind of revolution that we see here with exascale computing, that we see with big computers, this 20-year time machine that supercomputers represent, that we will have that capability of Mira, right, on a machine that will be in my car, right, or in my house. So we should be pondering those questions and thinking about those now.